Good evening. My name is Paul White from Communication Services Manitoba. Manitoba continues to make progress in its very measured science-based recovery in the battle against the worldwide pandemic known as COVID-19. As we draw closer to welcoming our students back and restoring safe schools, let's take a quick look back at the progress this province has made when it comes to education. On July 30th, Education Minister Calvin Goertzen announced K-12 classes would resume September 8th. On August 13th, the Manitoba government released practice guidance and protocols to ensure students, teachers, and families know what to expect upon returning to classrooms next month and to provide consistency across schools. And here we are this evening to discuss welcoming our students back for fall 2020 and to get your feedback on our plans to restore education services safely. The province is committed to being ready for what lies ahead, ready to live with COVID-19, ready to return to school, ready to start our services, create jobs, and grow our economy. If you have a question about our plan to restore schools safely, please press *3 at any time to speak to a moderator. Again, that's *3 at any time to submit your question. Joining us this evening will be the Honorable Calvin Goertzen, Minister of Education, Dr. Brent Rusin, Manitoba's Chief Provincial Public Health Officer, and Dana Rudy, the Acting Deputy Minister of Education. If you have a question that you would like one of these officials to answer, you can press *3 at any time. Minister Goertzen, can you get us started with opening remarks?
Yes, and thank you very much. I want to, first of all, thank everybody who's joined us this evening on the call. I know that on this beautiful summer day in Manitoba, there are many things that people would like to be doing, and it shows the priority that each of you place on education by being on the call here tonight. Want to thank our Chief Provincial Public Health Officer, Dr. Brent Rusin, who now has become a household name and trusted and respected around the province, in addition to around the country with his colleagues and others. And I know he's put in tremendous amount of work over the last several months, and we appreciate very much the leadership that he's provided from a public health perspective. And I know that those comments, I think, echo the feelings of all Manitobans. Also was introduced the Deputy Minister for the Department of Education, Dana Rudy, who's been working extremely hard together with officials in our department, stakeholders across the education system. Very thankful for her work as well. Perhaps most importantly, I want to acknowledge the work that's been done by parents and teachers and students over the last many months, particularly in that spring period when in-class learning was suspended. That was a difficult time for many, and for many different reasons. But we saw tremendous efforts being put in by all of our education professionals, parents doing the best that they could in a difficult situation, and students also working hard in a situation that they didn't expect to be in, and we're grateful for the efforts that they made. These are, of course, trying times for Manitobans, and while we have much to be thankful and optimistic for, it is a challenge, of course, in all places in Canada and around the world. It's anxious times. For parents, as we look forward to the return of school, there is, of course, anxiety. I am a parent myself of a school-age child who will be going back or entering high school this year for the first time, and my wife and I often talk about the kind of environment that he'll be entering, and we share our own anxieties about his return to school. That is not an unusual or a wrong feeling to have. I think as parents, we always have and will always have for the time that we are on this earth, have anxieties about our kids. And that is certainly, I think, part of being a parent. We know, however, how important it is for our young people, our students, to be back in school, to be back in the classrooms. While there were great efforts made in the spring by many people, there was a lot of difficult stories, and we heard them about how in home learning and not in class learning didn't go that well for many, many people. And that is a reality. While we are all in the same storm, we are not always all in the same boat, and we have to ensure that our young people get back into the classrooms, because we are, as Dr. Rusin often says, learning to live with this virus, and that there is more to public health than just the virus. There are negative impacts for young people not being in the classroom and not being able to get the in-class learning that they need. So while we know that distance learning in the spring was difficult, we do look forward to students returning in September. And I want to thank the school divisions and the officials at that level who have been working hard on their plans. They did a good job back in June when we had a partial reopening of the school. Only one of three provinces to have students back in school during that time, and while there were concerns at that time as well about whether or not students could return to the schools in a safe way, they did an excellent job, and I think it was very beneficial for students to be back and teachers to be back, and it showed that with good protocols in place that this could certainly work well. So we will continue to listen to parents and from those in the education system, which is a large part of what this evening is about. And of course, we heard from some 30,000 respondents when we did the back to school survey several weeks ago, and got some really good advice from parents and from teachers as well on a different survey, and from students. So that was really important to hear from all of those, because ultimately they are the consumers of our education system. So we, of course, continue to follow public health advice in all of the different things that are done. Protocols were released a couple of weeks ago. School divisions have followed up with their plans, and now we look forward to their more individualized plans at the individual school level. And certainly we all want information on these sort of things right away, as quickly as we can get it. As a parent, I feel exactly the same, but we also have to follow the right process to get to the right decisions and to get to that right planning. And so that often means a step-by-step process. The initial protocols that were put out were informed by what happened in June, including what happened during summer school and is happening during summer school, because we have had students in our classes all through the summer as well. As so we've been learning all along the way, both what happened when thousands of students went back to school in June very successfully, in summer school during the summer, even now, the protocols that were released, the division plans, and ultimately the individual school plans. So while we know that these aren't easy things to always achieve, they are important things to achieve, and we'll achieve them like Manitobans always do by working together. So I really look forward to hearing your questions, and hope that you'll be able to continue to provide your advice. If you're not able to ask a question tonight, you can do so online at EngageMB, where we have a dedicated team of individuals who are looking forward to responding to your questions quickly if they come up after today's call. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. Remember, if you'd like to ask a question this evening of Minister Gertsen, Dr. Rusin, or other government officials regarding our plans to restore safe schools, press star 3 at any time. Returning life to normal for Manitoba's kids is a priority for all of us. Students and teachers will have to make changes. As Minister Gertsen has mentioned, Manitoba's plan to restore schools safely must be based first and foremost on the advice and direction of our public health leaders. Let's hear now from our Chief Provincial Public Health Officer, Dr. Rusin. Welcome.
Oh, thank you. And thank you, Minister Gertsen, and thanks to everyone who's joining us tonight. When this novel virus was first introduced into Manitoba in March, we had to take extraordinary measures to flatten the curve through March, April, and May. This included the suspension of schools. These extraordinary measures were necessary but they did not come without a cost. We know that these lockdowns had significant impacts on their mental and physical health, and we know we just can't maintain that level of lockdown forever. As we've seen in the recent days and weeks, COVID-19 is not done with us, and it's not likely to be done with us in the next year and maybe longer. That's why we truly need to learn to live with this virus. And we can't simply return to significant lockdowns every time we see this virus in our communities because we know we're going to see this virus for the foreseeable future. Like we did months ago, we can flatten the curve again by focusing on the fundamentals. We know that this virus is predominantly spread by close, prolonged contact with people showing symptoms of COVID-19. And our fundamentals are based exactly on that. We need to stay home if we feel ill, even if we're feeling only a little unwell. And this is going to be paramount to our moving forward and living with this virus. We need to practice good hand hygiene. We don't share items with others. And we need to practice physical distancing when you're outside of your household and wearing a mask in indoor public places. If you start experiencing symptoms of COVID-19, self-isolate and go for testing immediately. Don't hesitate, even if the symptoms are mild. All these precautions will continue to help Manitoba flatten the curve. All these precautions will play a role when getting our children to return to school September 8th. Public Health has provided guidance on measures to utilize as students return to school in the next few weeks. These include, and again, based on their fundamentals, students grade 5 and up, teachers, staff, visitors, volunteers are strongly recommended to wear non-medical masks in common areas and where physical distancing of 2 meters is not possible. Non-medical masks are required for students grade 5 and up on buses. Drivers are also required to wear masks. Students grade 4 and lower can wear a non-medical mask if they choose. Consideration can be given to teachers and staff to wear face masks and eye protection, such as face shields. Masks will be provided at the school if needed. Physical distancing of 2 meters, 6 feet between all individuals should occur whenever reasonably possible in the school setting. When physical distancing is not possible, then we'll utilize cohorts to limit exposure and to facilitate contact tracing should a case be identified. Regular hand washing, including assistance to young children to ensure hand washing is done correctly. Respiratory etiquette, such as coughing into the elbow and disposing of used tissues in an appropriate way. In addition, increased frequency of cleaning and disinfection and sanitizing will be required, particularly in high-touch surfaces and in common shared areas. We know that there is less likelihood of transmission in well-ventilated environments, and so the following strategy should be considered to avoid recirculating of air to the greatest extent possible. In general, ventilating indoor environments with fresh air, whether by increasing outdoor air ratio of HVAC systems as much as possible, opening windows, and avoiding recirculation will all help to limit the risk. Even if it's not feasible for the whole facility, we can consider these measures in localized areas where crowding may be more of an issue. We're going to minimize the use of fans that can redirect air and could promote to increase spreading. Of course, we need to assess the risk of opening windows or doors when we're looking at ways to increase the ventilation. And like always, we encourage the use of outdoor space as much as possible when reasonable. We know that we've seen cases in our communities at the present time. We know some cases involve children. So we need to be prepared to see a case of COVID-19 in our school system. and we're prepared and have a plan to respond to such a case. And public health will work closely with school administrators in identifying the close contacts and notifying them and advising those close contacts to self-isolate. The areas of school where exposures took place will be cleaned and disinfected. These areas will not be used until determined to be safe to do so. School communities will be notified when a child in their school has been confirmed case, once close contacts have been identified and notified. All of these steps that we take are to avoid unnecessary closures of schools. We want to do a targeted case investigation and limit the impact of any case that it has on our school system. The closure of a school would be a last resort and only with evidence of transmission among multiple groups of students or staff. I recognize that there's a lot of anxiety on school approaches. I know that seeing some increased numbers in the last number of weeks in Manitoba increases that anxiety. We want to reassure teachers, administrators, parents, and teachers that our multi-layered approach and that when we work together and follow these guidelines, we're really limiting the risk. We know we never live in a risk-free society, and we're certainly never going to be in a risk-free situation when dealing with the pandemic. But we have these measures in place to reduce the risk. Public health will continually reassess the risk and act accordingly. But we truly are all in this together, and we have these guidelines in place to limit the risk for all involved. And so I really appreciate everyone signing in with us tonight and happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Doctor, and thank you, Minister, for those remarks and for your leadership over the past few months. We are now ready to take questions from Manitobans on the line. Remember, if you have a question about the Welcoming Our Students Back for Fall 2020 plan, please press star 3 to submit your question. First up from Winnipeg, we have Sean with a question about substitute teachers. Sean, are you on the line?
Hi there. So I've been hearing from substitute teachers that they are still planning on moving from school to school during the school year, which would give them quite a lot of exposure to multiple cohorts and multiple populations. Is that true? Is that really going to happen? And how is that not counter to the what we're trying to do with cohorts in order to limit exposure? If so.
Thanks very much, Sean, for the call. One of the challenges, of course, when we talk about cohorts or other things, the cohort is to ensure that we can do contact tracing, and in those cohorts, there can be a minimum of 1 meter distance between individuals and students. When it comes to substitutes or teachers more generally, and I know where the concern comes from, because what we saw early in the pandemic, it was somewhat related to personal care homes and the earlier outbreaks in British Columbia, in Ontario and Quebec, where we saw different workers who were moving between those facilities. Of course, the work that a nurse does in a personal care home is considerably different than the work that a teacher would do in a classroom, and where that distancing, sometimes of any kind of a distance, isn't possible for a nurse working in a personal care home. Our expectation is that teachers will be that 2 meters removed from the students, and so they will have that full 2 meters removed. So that should provide that assurance of distance for the substitutes, even if they are moving around between cohorts. Now, having said that, obviously, that's something that we're going to monitor and watch because, as you say, this is something that we want to be very careful about. But that 2 meters distancing that can be done with a substitute or with a teacher is something that gives us a little bit more assurance in talking with public health, but clearly something that we'll continue to watch and monitor.
Thank you, Minister. Up next is Tracy with a question about social distancing. Go ahead, Tracy.
Hi. I was just curious. I've heard that it, within schools, it was to be 1 meter away with teachers and students. And why is there a difference between in school as opposed to being out of school?
I think you were referring to the difference between the 1 meter and the 2 meter there. So I know that the 2 meters is the goal. That's ideal. And when that can be achieved, it should be achieved as much as reasonable. We know when it can't be achieved, then we're going to still require the 1 meter distancing between students. We're going to add the layer of protection of cohorts in that regard. We feel with teachers, though, we can still reach that 2 meter separation in most cases, just because of the makeup of that. So we're still, the physical distancing is still important, but it's not our only measure. We have a multi-layered approach in these schools.
Over to Shannon. Shannon, I believe your question is about classroom learning being suspended. Is that right? Go ahead.
Yes, thank you. So if a school is closed again temporarily, I would like to know how the quality of the teaching will be monitored. During the spring closure, my daughter only received 3 weeks' worth of activities from her teacher, and those activities seem to have been randomly chosen with no planning for desired outcomes. So how will the quality of the teaching be ensured if a school is closed temporarily?
Shannon, thank you very much for your question. And you really reinforced, I think, the point that was made at the beginning of the town hall, and that is that the experience of at-home learning wasn't the same for everyone. And that isn't to suggest that teachers or others in the education system weren't doing their best. I absolutely believe that they were. It's just that it was a situation that wasn't planned for, that it was difficult to foresee the pandemic coming and the outcome of it. Now, of course, we're much further into this, and so the planning from a provincial perspective does have a lot of different scenarios. So obviously we hope that whether it's in an individual school or overall when it comes to COVID-19 numbers, that we continue, that we have low numbers, and that we reach that point where we're consistently getting good outcomes. But we have to plan for a variety of different scenarios. And so the school divisions were asked back at the end of June to look at a variety of different scenarios. What would it look like if we were in level one, level two, level three, and to plan for that? So that included planning for at-home learning. So they've already been working up those plans. That's not the scenario that we're in now, but they have already developed plans in case we get to that scenario. So they'll be in a much better position, I believe, than we would have been or than we were in March. And I think you'll see that at the province as a whole from future announcements about the different levels of planning depending on what the scenario is at any given time, whether the numbers are quite low or whether they go into a different direction.
Thanks, Minister. A reminder to the folks on the phone, if you want to ask a question, please press star 3. That's star 3 if you want to try and ask us a question. Over to Taya from Winnipeg with a question regarding online options. Is that correct?
Hi there. Yes, it is. My question is, why can't there be an option for online learning for K-8? There are many parents that are very hesitant, like myself. I have 3 kids, sending them back into it, 2 that have health issues, and I would like to keep them home, and just being told that it's either you send them or it's homeschooling is kind of unnerving. Just wondering why, to make smaller classroom sizes, Can't a teacher be designated, say, per grade that also doesn't feel comfortable going into that situation? Can they be designated to online learning for those who want to stay home?
Thank you, Taylor, for the question. I think that you express very well a lot of the concerns that people might be feeling, and that I think is totally understandable, and I completely appreciate the perspective that you're bringing. Now, of course, I don't know the specific medical situation that you're talking about with your children. If there is a specific medical requirement for a student to remain home, whether that's during the school year and something happens, or it's something that's pre-existing or long-term, there are then supports put in place through the divisions to ensure that that at-home learning can happen. On a broader system-wide level, the challenge is probably twofold. One is that we know, and it was certainly experienced in spring, that those grades from K to 8 are probably the least likely to do well with at-home learning or trying to do some kind of self-instruction if they don't have a lot of good guidance. And that is a real challenge, particularly at those younger grades, less so when it comes to the high school grades. And we saw that in the spring where there were online resources, they were to be moved in quickly. And that some of those who took advantage of that in high school did better. So that's the one sort of practical reality of the ability for those younger students to do online learning. The other challenge, of course, is that we do expect that teachers will be more at a premium this year than they have been in the past. And there are plans being worked up in terms of how to deal with some of that. And the divisions, of course, have brought forward some ideas. But we do know that Dr. Rusin has continued to remind us that if we are feeling sick, we need to stay home. Now, that applies to students, but it equally applies to staff within the school system. So our expectation, not our hope, but our expectation would be that there is going to be a higher absentee level this year, both among students and probably also among staff because of that, particularly as we get into the flu season. So it would be difficult for teachers to maintain that dual track system. We did hear from a lot of teachers even in June where they were concerned about that really short period of time where we had some students back on a relatively short period of time of in-class learning, but also continue on with some at-home learning, that wasn't sustainable for them in the long term. It was difficult in June. So there's both sort of a practical reality on the ability for those younger students to learn online, and then also that reality that we're going to have we think we're going to have some challenges, obviously, with teachers being at a premium.
Next up, we have John with a question regarding cohorts and masks. Did I get that right, John?
Yes, you did. My question is regarding the fact that in cohorts, we are reducing the social distancing to only 1 meter. Now, that to me seems like it would actually increase the potential of transmission inside the cohort. And so cohorts to me seem to be more of a school resiliency measure than a measure designed to keep staff and students safe. Is there any sense in recommending masks to ensure that cohorts don't become more destructive than they could wind? Is there any rationale to having masks so that the cohorts do not wind up getting more people sick?
Yeah, and so this again, we're talking about our multi-layered approach to this, and so we know about staying home when you're sick. We talk about the physical distancing, and so physical distancing isn't absent from those cohorts. It has to be a minimum of 1 meter. We know that ideally it would be 2 meters, but we know that's not always possible. So we do have the distancing of that 1 meter. The cohorting is an additional measure. So instead of having, the distancing of 1 meter with multiple contacts throughout the day, we're limiting it to just within that cohort. So we know that the larger the amount of people that you can be in contact with, the more likely someone in that group is ill, the more likely they can spread it to more people, and the more difficult it is to find out who they've been in contact with. So that's why cohorts are useful, because we limit the overall number of people you're going to be in contact during a day. And so masks are an additional measure. So masks are an added layer onto this. So we are highly recommending the masks for grade 5 and up. Again, it's not a replacement for any of those other multi-layers, but it is an additional factor that will add to the protection.
Thank you. We now go to Patty with a question about the return to the classroom and students with special needs. Did I get that right, Patty? Go ahead.
Hi. I'm just wondering about, I have a special needs child, and even though there's only approximately 6 to 8 per little classroom, they don't understand personal space or boundaries. Everything is hand-mouth touch. They go to school with only approximately 3 to 4 other kids in a van. How is that going to work, considering, like I said, they don't understand social distancing, no personal spaces. They can't wear masks. They have, issues on that. I have no guidance, and I'm very worried about my child returning full-time per Manitoba's plan.
Yeah, thank you very much, Patty, and thank you for the question. We do have guidelines that are in place for staff who are particularly working with children with special needs. There are going to be, more specific individual education plans for all of those students, and we'll continue to work closely with Student Service Administration on those plans. There have been some working groups, some focus groups together with parents to get a sense of what some of those challenges are. You've identified a lot of them in your call right now, and so that's being worked into the guidelines that are provided to staff. But you rightly recognize some of those challenges, particularly with our special needs students, and so that is a particular focus of the department and the divisions and the work that's going on.
A reminder, if you want to ask a question of our people tonight, you can press star three to ask a question about welcoming our students back for fall 2020. We go now to Brenda, who wants to talk about making masks mandatory for staff and students. Brenda, go ahead.
Okay, I was just wondering, why is the wearing of masks not mandatory for all staff and students? I understand there could be special circumstances, but Dr. Rusin, you've mentioned that nothing's off the table. This needs to be on the table.
Yeah, and so certainly this is on the table. We leave all our options always available to us. When we look to, and this is just sort of the public health approach to things, we've seen right from the beginning that we guide Manitobans, we provide recommendations, and up to now our recommendations have been followed. And so certainly mask use is important. And and we may at some point require masks, mandate masks. But as we strongly recommend it, and if we get good compliance with that, then there won't be a need to mandate it. So we'll follow this closely. I used an example earlier on a town hall of childhood immunizations. Childhood immunizations are a much more important public health intervention than masks. But we have a good uptake, so that's why we don't mandate them in Manitoba. And so it's certainly not off the table, and we'll continue to follow that. But thanks for that question.
Thank you. Time for the folks on the line now to answer a question for us. Here comes the question and then the instructions. How comfortable are you with schools using remote learning in the fall, if that is necessary? Press 1 for very comfortable. Press 2 for somewhat comfortable. Press 3 for somewhat uncomfortable. And press 4 for very uncomfortable. So how comfortable are you with schools using remote learning in the fall, if it's necessary? Again, press 1 if you're very comfortable, press 2 if you are somewhat comfortable, press 3 if you are somewhat uncomfortable, and press 4 if you are very uncomfortable. All right, we'll go back to our callers on the line now. To Jody, who has a question about students with medical conditions going back to school. Jody, go ahead.
Hi there. My question is, I'm wondering what supports are going to be available to children who have a medical condition and are high risk and can't go back to school to ensure they don't fall further behind their peers. In our situation, my daughter is waiting for a transplant. I have currently talked to our division and nothing is in place for these children, with the thoughts of them just staying at home and doing remote learning on their own, like we already did in the spring.
Thank you for the question. And of course, our thoughts are with you and your daughter. She waits the transplant. That subject is very near to my heart, particularly in the last few days. But I would say that there have been specific instructions that have been provided to the division in terms of getting individual plans for those students who, for whatever reason, aren't able to go to school for a verified medical reason. If you have not had that contact from your division, I would ask that you connect with my office in Winnipeg, and we can do that follow up for you. I believe though that the division should have, and they've not contacted you. Certainly, are working on an individual plan for your child, but we'd be happy to do the follow up for you to make sure that that happens.
Thank you, Minister. And a reminder: if you have a question about welcoming our students back for fall 2020, please press star 3 to submit your question. Marge in St. Andrews has a question about masks. Is that correct, Marge?
That is correct. You have mentioned that this virus will be with us for quite some time. So what I would like to see is all students, even in kindergarten, and all staff wearing masks. In younger grades, students tend to play next to each other. They do a lot of hands-on activities in the younger grades, and at least if they were wearing masks, you wouldn't have to try so hard to keep them apart. And I think if this is going to be our new normal, it's something that students and staff would have to just get used to for the hopefully short term, but maybe for a bit longer than that.
Yeah, and thanks. Thanks for that. And I think that there's a the national guidance on masks in schools have that age at 10 and up. This is for two reasons. One, we know that the transmission of the virus is less so the younger the child is. The other thing is just the expectation of adherence to proper mask use. And so the amount of times that these kids would be touching their face and bringing the mask down is really counterproductive to the using the mask. So that's really the thought process behind that. What that age limit is, granted is a bit arbitrary. Is it age 8? Is it age 10? And then the thing on top of that I would say is that, again, the masks are that add-on. They can't be expected to substitute for all those other fundamentals. And so we have to do whatever we can to get those other fundamentals in place, the masks added on. But 6-year-olds in a 7-hour day wearing a mask, I don't think we're going to have useful adherence to that. And that's where the national recommendations come from. But in saying that, we have to adapt. We continue to follow what the evidence is. We'll follow what guidelines are. And so so we're going to continue to look at how we recommend mask use.
Now we go to Angela, who's concerned with the number of cases on the rise and students that may have been traveling. Is that right, Angela? Go ahead. Angela, are you there?
Hi, yes, I am. My question is regarding travel. So we've seen that with people coming back into the province now with opening some of the borders, will the school divisions or schools have the ability to mandate students to stay home for 2 weeks if they're returning out of province?
So as of right now, it would be the public health orders that that rule that. And so if they were returning from international travel or travel that's still contained in the public health orders, which is out east, then they would still be required to self-isolate under those orders. We continue to look at the implications of our travel orders and whether they need to be reinstated. We don't have any imminent plans for that. But as of right now, would be the current public health orders that are in effect.
Over to Chrissy in St. Andrews with a question about funding for substitute teachers. Go ahead, Chrissy.
Hi. So I am both a parent and a teacher, and in the last 10 years in the classroom, we are noticing vacancies for substitute teachers. The positions aren't getting filled on a daily basis. So I'm wondering if there is extra funding getting provided to the school divisions from the province to ensure that those positions are filled as needed.
Thank you very much, Chrissy, and for your you're looking at things from two perspectives, both as a parent and as a teacher. So I really appreciate your call and that perspective. So we have been speaking with school divisions now for many months about what this fall could look like. Of course, those discussions started long before we had any idea of what the COVID situation might be like at this time or in September. But we had to prepare for a number of different scenarios. So in the spring, when the in-class learning was suspended, we knew that there would be quite a bit of savings that were garnered by the school divisions because things like busing weren't happening as they were before, those sort of things. So we asked them to hold those savings, knowing that whatever situation we would be in the fall would probably require some additional funding. And so school divisions collectively were able to save a little more than $40 million, I believe. So they currently have that to use in terms of the needs that they have going back into the fall. But we also recognize as a government that there are going to be needs that are over and above that. And so one of the ones that was recognized early and brought to our attention by the school divisions was the need for masks. So there is the strong recommendation when it comes to the wearing of masks. But we know that there also has to be equity in that as well, and that we have to ensure that all students have the ability to access those masks to follow the public health advice, and even to the extent that young people might have those masks now, and of course it's a lot more common than it would have been back in March, they sometimes forget them or different sort of things happen and they don't end up in school with them. And so we are providing several million dollars to purchase those masks, and we've said to the school divisions, let's continue that dialogue in terms of what you think the other situations are going to be that you're going to need some support on. So they have their own savings from the spring, which total over $40 million, and then we are already starting the process of supporting them in other things where there's a demonstrated need, like, for example, the most recent commitment to purchase masks for students right across the provincial system.
Thank you, Minister. Speaking of masks, it's time for those of you on the phone to answer another one of our questions. Here is our question. How comfortable are you with your child wearing a non-medical mask during in-class school hours? Press 1 if you are very comfortable. Press 2 for somewhat comfortable. Press 3 for somewhat uncomfortable, and press 4 for very uncomfortable. Once again, how comfortable are you with your child wearing a non-medical mask during in-class school hours? Press 1 for very comfortable. Press 2 for somewhat comfortable. Press 3 for somewhat uncomfortable. And press 4 for very uncomfortable. We go now to Nicole with a question about learning at home. Is that right, Nicole?
Yes, correct.
Go ahead.
Okay, so I understand that, you know, we need to get kids back to school, and I understand the challenges that, you know, families face at home with remote learning. And my understanding is that there are going to be things put in place for children who attend school that are immune compromised. Are there going to be any options for families who have family members living at home that are immune compromised? We have an adult child with Down syndrome. She is very medically compromised. We've had all our kids home for the last 5 months. There's really been no, you know, interactions, no germs, and we know that cold and flu season is coming. I feel like I'm having to choose between my daughter's health and my other two's education. Why can there not be a compromise?
So, I think that as we're, learning, to live with this virus, and as you said, the importance of getting people back in class, there's going to be situations that we're still going to have to adapt to. So we certainly expected children that may have medical issues that on the advice of their physician would not be able to go back to class for certain periods of time or perhaps the entire year. And then there's plans to support that. And then there's issues that you just brought back, but that whether it was not necessarily the child, but a family member where it's important like this. So, so these are things that we're still looking at on how we could address that, on how we could support that and deal with that. So I think this is something that's probably still in the works for some of these type of specific scenarios.
Thank you, Doctor. We now go to Tracy with a question about a student testing positive in a classroom. What happens then? Is that your question, Tracy? Go ahead.
Yes, I was just curious how it would work. So let's say a child tests positive in a cohort. Does the cohort of students then have to self-isolate for 14 days, or do they just watch for symptoms? And then also what happens to the teacher? And if the teacher has that scenario more than once throughout the school year, if they have to self-isolate more than once, isn't that going to be a thing of running out of sick time, that sort of thing?
Okay, yeah, so great question. So let me, I'll tackle the public health aspect of that question. And like we said, that we've seen cases in our communities right now. We've seen cases in children right now, and they're not in school right now. So we need to expect to see cases in our schools. And so when a case is confirmed in a child that had been at school and it's determined to be the infectious period, then public health will do the contact investigation. So we will be informing school administration of this positive case. We'll do a contact investigation, which would include looking to see who those close contacts were with that child, and that is greater than 15 minutes in that proximity of 2 meters. And that could include up to an entire cohort. It could be able to be narrowed down to just a few members of that cohort. So it really depends on the situation. But we are planning to communicate this. So we're going to inform the school community that a case has been discovered. We're going to inform the people who have been discovered to be close contacts. And you're right, those people will need to self-isolate for 14 days. If the teacher was determined to be in that close prolonged contact, then they too will have to self-isolate for those 14 days. And then we're going to communicate to the school broadly and indicate that a case has been detected, that all the close contacts have already been identified and are self-isolating. If you were not informed of the need to self-isolate, then we will continue to offer services at that school for the rest of the children. So it really depends on the situation. The idea behind the all of that layered approach is to minimize the number of close contacts, and then the idea of the cohorts is to have a maximum, that we're not going to need to shut down a school when we see a single case. We may, in that situation, have to self-isolate an entire cohort, but because of all those other measures, our real goal is to not have to resort to the entire cohort, that we could find close contacts within there.
We go to Anita with a question about the 14-day isolation. Anita, are you there? Go ahead and ask your question.
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, please proceed.
Will you consider a mandatory 14-day isolation for all visitors to Manitoba, including those coming from Western provinces, to provide one more precaution in helping to stop the spread of the virus into our province, so that our children, which is the future of our province and economy, are able to spend as much time as possible in school until the flu season and everything does catch up with us?
Yeah, and thanks for that. I mean, and certainly, by the way, it's phrased, we consider, it's absolutely, we've always considered any public health measure that we think would be a benefit. Like we said at the beginning, the strict public health measures, including those travel restrictions, did not come without a cost. There is a major impact, not only on our economy from that, but on family reunifications and many other issues. So certainly we always consider these things. We watch the epidemiology in those other provinces and weigh the risks and benefits of imposing another travel restriction on that. And so we really don't take any options off the table, and so we absolutely will continue to look at that.
We go to Brandon and Holly with a question about music and music teachers. Go ahead, Holly.
Yes, hello. Would elementary music teachers be able to have students come to the music classroom if 1 meter of social distancing can be done with large groups of students? Of about 25 to 30, like my classroom.
Thanks very much for the question. I know that music is really, really important to many Manitobans. My son has been very active in the music programs that he's had within his school, and I think it's one of the great joys that he's been able to have and continue to develop outside of school. So we do hear from a lot of parents that this is a really, really important part of their education for their young people. Now, we do have guidelines that are in place now, and they've been up on the website in terms of fires and in terms of bans for quite some time now. So there are specific guidelines for that. So there is the ability to look at those guidelines and see how it fits within your school's context. I do know that the divisions are challenged, obviously, with certain things, and then part of that can be space considerations within their own individual schools that they're looking to access additional space for students for an in-class environment that might not include music. They might have challenges in terms of cohorting or ensuring that individuals aren't moving around to too many cohorts, and so that is something that I think we know is a reality for the individual schools and divisions who are doing the planning, but there are guidelines in place that allow for how those activities can take place in a safe way.
Wendy has a question regarding communications and, again, COVID-19 contacts. Is that right, Wendy? Go ahead.
Hi there. My name is Wendy, and I guess I was just wondering if someone develops COVID within the high school, will the entire school community be informed, or would it just be that one classroom?
Yeah, and thanks for that. And you know, I think that as we're dealing with this virus, and as we've just our strategy moving forward, you see that we're trying to share much more information with Manitobans about the geographic location of cases, and you'll see tomorrow our pandemic response system that we'll be releasing that will provide a lot more information to Manitobans. So the answer is yes, that when we're going to inform Manitobans when we find cases in schools, we'll certainly be informing the close contacts first and then that school community, but we'll be informing Manitobans of cases in schools and provide as much information as we can.
And to Diane we go with a question about students that may have some anxiety about going back to school or in the classroom. Go ahead, Diane.
Hi there. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Please proceed.
Okay. Mine's kind of a difficult question because it's a little bigger than I was hoping it would be, but I'll try and make it as simple as possible. I have a child who was in the middle of a psychological assessment to determine individual needs, who had already sort of felt falling through the cracks, which took 2.5 years to get. And then this pandemic came on, and the whole try to learn at home thing was not working whatsoever. Very reserved child I have, who also has a grandma in a nursing home. So this is just an added anxiety for a child like mine who needs in-person learning, but also has added anxiety on top of what she's already facing academically, with a grandma in a nursing home on oxygen who's dying. So she's very afraid to bring it home. And I'm also in one of two essential family members allowed to see my mom. So I don't really know how a school would deal with a situation like mine, since she's already not been fully assessed for individual needs that kind of affect an invisible illness right now, or anxiety that we're in the middle of determining what is going to happen with her. What I haven't heard anything. So can you ensure that there would be extra help for a child like mine?
And thank you for raising that question. And I think that you really did a great job of encapsulating within your own family situation, a lot of the different things that individual families are dealing with during the pandemic. Now, you're dealing with a lot of them collectively at the same time within your household, but I know that a lot of those individual concerns will be faced by a number of different families. So we have, in working with the school divisions, you know, asked them particularly to put together a mental health and well-being strategy and a plan, because we know that this is going to be something different. And so for your child, I think that, you know, we would want to ensure that individual plan, of course, is happening with the division specifically. And that may have been something that, you know, was required even before the pandemic, but now particularly with additional anxieties that she might be facing because of the pandemic, we'd want to ensure that the school division's plans address the need for your child as well. And so we will certainly remind and work with them to ensure that those plans are in place. But I appreciate you raising this particular, because there's a lot of things we know and a lot of things that we don't know. And one of the things that we think we know is that there is going to be an increased anxiety among young people, but we don't know to what extent that's going to be, or what that might look like, or which child or children that it might particularly affect. We can make guesses and we can sort of assume, but this is the first time that any of us are living through this in our lifetime. And so there's a lot of learning that's happening. So there are resources in place when it comes to mental health supports within the school system. There may be some additional things that are being looked at, but we also have to see on a more general basis, not specific to your child, but on a more general basis, what does it look like going back for students? Because it might not be exactly as we think, and the organizations that are already doing some work, like Shelton Kennedy's organization, Respect in Schools, or maybe the True North Youth Foundation, who are already doing work in schools. I mean, they will be looking to tailor some of their work as well as it relates to the different things that may have arisen for children as a result of being at home in the spring, but then also the general anxiety they might have because of the pandemic. So it's a very real question of concern for all of us as parents, something that I think about in my family context as well. So I'm very, very thankful that you've raised that question.
Thank you, Minister. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have for questions tonight. We know that there are many questions that we were not able to answer. The survey on engagemb.ca is still open. Please visit engagemb.ca to provide your feedback on welcoming our students back for fall 2020. After the call, you will be directed to a voicemail message box if you have any additional comments you'd like to share with the minister or government. Please stay on the line to leave a message. And before we end, Minister Gertsen, do you have any closing remarks you'd like to share?
Thank you. You know, I just really want to say how grateful I am that so many thousands of people came on to this call to listen this evening. I know that this is a top concern for Manitobans. Our government understands that, and it's true across the country. We hear right across the country that parents have questions about the return of their children to school. And so we continue to take advice from public health. They've done a tremendous job up until this point. We know that they'll continue to, and we want to thank Dr. Rustin and his team, not only for just his participation tonight, he also participated in a town hall with school officials this afternoon and was answering questions for them as well. And so we very much appreciate their support. And for all of us, I hope that, you know, you have the opportunity still relatively early on a beautiful Manitoba evening to be able to get out and enjoy the many wonderful things that we do have to be thankful for in this province as we look forward optimistically to the return of students to school and optimistically for the great things that Manitoba has in store in the days and the weeks ahead. So thank you again for being with us this evening. I very much appreciate it, as I know all of the people who participated do appreciate it as well.
Thanks again, Minister Gertsen and Dr. Rusin, for your time tonight. Please stay on the line if you have any additional comments you'd like to share with the minister or government. Your call will be directed to a voicemail box. And don't forget, the survey on engagemb.ca is still open. Please visit engagemb.ca to provide your feedback on welcoming our students back for fall 2020 as the province restores schooling safely. Thank you and have a good night.